Good morning. It's nice to see all of you again. So, those of you who weren't here last week, the voice and the coughing, I did go to the doctor and get COVID tests, and I am negative. This is an allergy-related thing, so when you see me coughing and that, you won't catch allergies. So they are getting a little better, but not as good as I would like. So that's just the way life goes sometimes. If you look in your bulletin on the little flap verse down on the bottom, it's a familiar verse, and it is a good lead-in. And as you'll see as we go through the service, it's a good tie-in for what we're doing today. From Matthew 6, verse 21, "For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." The reality of that, knowing those priorities, those things that take a priority in our heart, do take a priority in our living. And we want that to be God. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for your word and your truth, the reality of it. Some things are just so obvious, we overlook them sometimes. Seems silly, but that's the way. That's one of the things that happens for us. The reality of what we treasure. When we stop and we think about it, there's a lot of different things we would put on that list. Certainly people would be among those, and I'm grateful for those people that you've given that have had input into my life. And again, all these folks here gathered together here have had a tremendous input into my life. And I thank you for the way in which you allow us to interact with each other, for the connection that you've given us in Christ, the reality of what it means to have a relationship to him and to be able to be transformed by you, to be able to be led by you. We are not off on our own. It's not something that we have to guess about. It's something that you want very much for us to understand your leading and your direction and your guiding. So we pray that you open our eyes to hear, our hearts to pay attention to you, to be more sensitive to you. I remember that some of the verses that talk about a calloused heart. Boy, we don't ever want that. Not even in any area, Father. We want to keep our heart open to you and sensitive to you. Father, when I think of really the privilege, the honor of being able to gather together as the body of Christ, as you made that picture clear in Scripture that we all work together, fit together, are part of being yours, we are incomplete without one another. How foolish to think that we can be yours on our own, that we can be all you've called us to be on our own. Your word's very clear that's not the case. I thank you for all those who put work into the service, who put work and time into the ministries of the church. Help us to be attentive to you, and when you call, that we would step up, that we would respond to you. We want to be a church that makes disciples as you've called us to, and we need your guidance and direction in that. As we're gathered together here, there are some who can't, who have not been able to get together with us. Some because of physical challenges for them, and some because of fear. And for all that, Father, we really want to see you break through and bring healing. And it's healing not only physically, but that emotional and spiritual healing too. We are not perfect. We are people who need your touch. We are people who need your power at work in us and through us. Thank you for the time we can get together and listen to the word. In a bit, as scriptures are read to us, and as we have time later in the service to go through and stop and look and pay a little bit more attention, Lord, your word is powerful and effective. I pray that you would help us. Help us to open ourselves up, and help us to be, sometimes it just goes off like, you know, we've heard this before and our mind wanders, draw us back to you. And as we sing songs and they express what an amazing God you are and what a privilege it is to have a relationship with you and to be able to stand for you, Father, help these to be expressions of our heart, testimonies of your awesomeness, of the privilege and honor of having a relationship with you. And the Lord, help us to minister to one another in the power of the Spirit, that we will know that we have met with you as we meet with each other, and that we will know that when we leave, we may be separated from one another, but we're not separated from you. So, Father, to you, we want to commit this time with thanks and with expectation. Accept our worship and help to refine us more and more in the people of Christ. And it's in his name we gather and in his name we pray. Amen. Well, if you glance at the bulletin, you'll see there's a few things going on. Just want to point out the Acorn Bank breaking is in 3 weeks on the 17th of October. Usually we've done it in June, but you know, the last couple of years have been a little different. So we're going to be doing it in on October 17th, 9:30, over in the old library. It just show up. You say, I don't know where the old library is. Show up and, you know, we'll make sure that you get there. On that, if you need an Acorn Bank, they're out in the lobby. The Acorn Bank, the money from the Acorn Bank goes to help with the expenses of education for our missionary children on the field. And it's a way for us to be able to come alongside and encourage them. We hope to start Kids Club up in on October 6th. Linda's talked with some of you about that already. Just want to let you know that we'll be doing that on Wednesday. That's not this Wednesday, but a week from Wednesday. That'll start up again so that the younger kids are able to come. And then if you're interested in the flu shot, the sign-up list is out in the lobby. That's cost you nothing. And the rough draft on the church directory, make sure you check that and get make any corrections that need to. Next Sunday will be communion. Our communion offering is going to the Gideon Ministry this month for October. So as you gather together and think about that, it is an opportunity for us to be able to come alongside and help them share the Word of God. What a great ministry, great thing. So that'll be next Sunday. Now John is, at least that's what it says there, Jackie is going to come and lead us in Jonah chapter 3. Turn to Jonah chapter 3 if you're using a pew Bible. It's page 852.
He said I was the better half, so I guess we're kind of one in the same. But yes, Jonah chapter 3. This is a mighty example of when we obey the Lord's calling in our lives and are willing to share his message of grace and mercy, how he can change other people's lives through us. So Jonah chapter 3. Then the word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time. Get up, go to the great city of Nineveh, and preach the message that I tell you. So Jonah got up and went to Nineveh according to the Lord's command. Now Nineveh was an extremely large city, a three-day walk. Jonah set out on the first day of his walk in the city and proclaimed, in 40 days Nineveh will be demolished. The men of Nineveh believed in God. They proclaimed a fast and dressed in sackcloth, from the greatest of them to the least. When the word reached the king of Nineveh, he got up from his throne, took off his royal robe, put on sackcloth, and sat in ashes. Then he issued a decree in Nineveh. By order of the king and his nobles, no man or beast, herd or flock is to taste anything at all. They must not eat or drink water. Furthermore, both man and beast must be covered with sackcloth, and everyone must call out earnestly to God. Each must turn from his evil ways and from the violence he is doing. Who knows? God may turn and relent. He may turn from his burning anger so that we will not perish. Then God saw their actions, that they had turned from their evil ways. So God relented from the disaster he had threatened to do to them, and he did not do it.
Good morning. Our second reading is going to be 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 9 to 11. It's page 1053 in your pew Bible, if you want to turn there. Don't you know that the unrighteous will not inherit God's kingdom? Do not be deceived. No sexual immoral people, idolaters, adulterers, or anyone practicing homosexuality. No thieves, greedy people, drunkards, verbally abusive people, or swindlers will inherit God's kingdom. And some of you used to be like this, but you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God.
Praise the Lord.
We have the opportunity to praise the Lord in a lot of different ways. How we live our life, how we give our life, how we respond to Him. The offering is also an expression of our praise and how we respond to Him. And what we return is simply a part of what He's given and entrusted to our care to use in ways that we might honor Him. As the ushers come forward to receive your gifts and offerings, let's pray together. You are indeed most holy Lord, the only holy Lord. You are worthy of praise. We've been singing about that. Now we respond in giving an act of praise to you. Continue to guide us as a church to use the funds that you've given us, the missionaries, the organizations we're able to come alongside of and help support, that they too will be clearly led by you. And that we in our homes will use all that you've given in a way that brings praise to your name, we ask. We give freely. We give as an expression of our thanks and praise. In Christ's name. Go ahead and dismiss the children for Children's Church at this time. So I pressed the button. I thought I did that. Did I do that? There is a song, I don't know if the kids sing it, or I'll do that later. Or downstairs now or not, and it is a Sunday school song, a kid's Sunday school song. I wasn't in a church that had Sunday school when I was a kid, you know, so I didn't learn it there. I learned it somewhere, though. It is not politically correct, you know. In fact, but it's a fun song in an earworm kind of way. Zacchaeus was a wee little man, and a wee little man was he. He climbed up in the sycamore tree for the Lord he wanted to see. So here's you know, the couple of questions for you to think about as we look at this passage. Do you want to see the Lord? Now, we use that phrase sometimes, meaning that, well, that would be nice. For example, you know, I would like to see my sisters. You know, I have three sisters, two in the Chicago area, one lives in Florida. And I would like to see my sisters, meaning it would be nice. So, you know, my first question to you is, do you want to see the Lord? The second question is, what are you doing about it? You see, because while I could tell you I'd like to see my sisters, meaning it would be nice, I'm not doing anything about it. You see, I'm not doing anything to make that happen. So, you know, when we think, you know, that, you know, the Lord, we want to see the Lord, you know, do you want to see the Lord? Well, what are you doing about it? Let's pray. We're going to look at our passage about Zacchaeus today. Father, thank you for your word to us. We sometimes like it, and we sometimes, well, if we're real honest, sometimes we get annoyed, not because of your word, but because of what it reveals about us. Annoyed is not the position we want to be in. What we want to be in is that position that allows us to not only see you more clearly, and we definitely need that. We need to see you more clearly. But we need to take it beyond that to the reality of opening our life to you in a way that it changes our life, in a way in which we are continuing to be made new for you, in which we are continuing to follow you. Teach us from your word today. Maybe we'll see some things in a familiar story that we haven't really paid too much attention to before. And maybe you'll simply remind us of something that we need to be reminded of. So we open ourselves to you as we open your word. With thanks, we pray. In Christ's name, amen. We're going to be in Luke chapter 19, so if you're using a pew Bible, it's page 966. If you're using your phone, it's somewhere else. If you know, so you can go ahead and get to it however you get to it. We're going to go through the first 10 verses. Now, not all at once. We're going to hit, you know, 2, 3, 1, and then things like that. We'll see, and I'm simply going to share some observations and applications with you as I move through the text, but they relate to those questions I asked at the beginning, because as I was thinking through it, this is just kind of what God was asking me, you know, do you want to see me, and what are you going to do about it, you know, what are you doing about it? So follow along. Verse 1 says, he entered Jericho. That's Jesus, entered Jericho and was passing through. There was a man named Zacchaeus who was a chief tax collector, and he was rich. He was trying to see who Jesus was, but he was not able to because of the crowd, since he was a short man. So running ahead, he climbed up a sycamore tree to see Jesus, since he was about to pass that way. When Jesus came to the place, he looked up and said to him, Zacchaeus, hurry and come down, because today I must stay at your house. Now we're going to pause there for a minute. Notice it says he was a chief tax collector. That would be a very lucrative position. Now, somebody who has a lucrative position isn't necessarily going to be rich. It depends on what they do with their money and how they use their money. You could make a lot of money and give a lot of money away. You could make a lot of money and foolishly waste it. You can make a lot of money and, you know, and end up with nothing, you see. But here he says he was a chief tax collector, and he was rich. He became a rich man at the expense of those he collected taxes from. He became a rich man of those who were there, those who lived there, and they resented him for it. They resented the fact that he got rich off of them paying taxes. Not too many people enjoy paying taxes. I know there's probably one or two of you, you know, that do, but not too many people enjoy that. They didn't enjoy it either, and they resented Zacchaeus for his role in that. They saw him, well, as not just the fact that he got rich off of them, but in their minds, he did it as being a traitor. You see, because he collected taxes for the Romans. The Romans occupied Jerusalem, occupied where God's people lived. And they, you know, as the occupying force, then they, you know, collected taxes whether they liked it or not, you see. And Zacchaeus then joins together with them in doing that, in collecting the taxes. So he, you know, that position would not have been, while it was lucrative, it wouldn't have been an enviable position if you want to have friends. Now, Zacchaeus' curiosity here gets more, he desired to see Jesus. You know, it says that Jesus was passing through there, and he desired to see, notice what it says, he wanted to see who Jesus was. That was interesting to me. He wants to know more about Jesus, and that motivated him to do something. Because he wanted to see him, it motivated him to do something about it, even though it may have been seen as undignified for this man, this rich man, to climb up into this tree. And it may have seemed undignified. He took up this position in the tree to get a good look. Now, it probably wasn't too out of the ordinary. I remember seeing pictures of Wrigley Field before they made the walls higher and put the other buildings there. And there's people standing in the trees watching the baseball game. I've seen the same thing for the track down at Indy. People standing in the trees and sitting in the trees across on the outside of the Indianapolis Motor Speedway watching the race. You see, I mean, this isn't anything new. This is something that was done, you know, so it probably wasn't too out of the ordinary. But here's the point. He put in the effort to make sure he saw Jesus. He was, as the chief tax collector, you see, it was not only a lucrative position, but it was a busy position because people didn't always necessarily want to pay their taxes, you know, and you chase the people down and you do what you got to do. You know, but here he set time aside and he overcame the obstacles. The obstacles would be not just his height, but notice what it says. It says there that he couldn't see them. He wasn't able to see them because of the crowd. We've gone to the zoo with our grandchildren, and one of the things, you know, you get to by the otters or the lion or something, there's a glass thing there, you know, and you have to move up to it. And one of the things I notice is people very often will let, you know, kids or shorter people get up there because they can look over them. Zacchaeus wasn't a well-liked man. So when it says because of the crowd, it's because they weren't going to give him any help at all. They weren't going to be any help to him. In fact, they would do what they could be to be a hindrance to him, I would think. You know, but he set that time aside. He overcame the obstacles. He made sure he did it. We need to put in the effort that we need to see Jesus. If you want to see him, put in the effort necessary to see him. This right here, this point right here, is where a lot of us fall down. This is the weak link for us. The weak link we don't make an intentional, deliberate effort. Effort is more than saying, well, I tried. How? How did you try? How is it? What did you do? What did you do in order to see? Well, you know, I prayed this morning and then I was, you know, distracted and I went on about my day. How is it, you know, if we try, how did you try? What did you actually do? What did you actually put into place? Not just thinking about it, not even just developing a mental plan. What physical actions did you do? What steps of action did you take that shows you put in the effort to see Jesus? It says, since he was a short man. Now notice, he didn't use that as an excuse and walk away. Quit making excuses. Well, I'm busy, Pastor. You don't understand. Don't worry about what Pastor thinks. You know, worry about what the Lord thinks. I'm a busy man. It sounds a little different when we're saying that when we're saying that to God. Doesn't it? I mean, you know, we could say it to one another, but you don't understand my schedule. Sounds a little odd if we're going to say that to God, doesn't it? But you don't understand my schedule. You don't understand how busy I am. Let me rephrase that for you. You don't understand how busy I've made myself. Maybe that's a little closer to the truth for us. Problem is, we don't understand how busy we've made ourselves. Quit making excuses. He could have made excuses. He had a job that was a busy job, that was a job that would take, you know, more than just him. That's why it says he was the chief tax collector. So he most likely oversaw other tax collectors. You know, so there was a busy position here. You know, it says, you know, he did what he needed to do to actually make it happen. Look at verse 4. It says he went ahead, he ran ahead, he prepared. I don't want to hurt your feelings, but you don't prepare because you don't want to. I mean, isn't that the truth for us? No, I want to. No, if you want to, you'd do it. We don't prepare because we don't want to. Because we don't want to take that time. We don't want to put that effort in. We don't want to have our schedule. We don't, you know, we want to do something. We want to do some. I'll say this, and we'll say, oh, no, that's not true. We want to do something else more than we want to see Jesus. Well, that's not true. I can only judge by our actions. I can only judge by the actions. We want to do something else more than we want to see Jesus. We want to do something else more than we want to spend time with him, which, you know, is the battle for us here. You know, the battle is putting in that effort, and we need to quit making excuses. What I like, you see in verse 5, Jesus responds to his efforts, and he responds to them in a very personal way. He looks up, you know, and again, we're not told, but I don't think Zacchaeus was the only one in the tree. That's just my opinion. It's just a thought. It's, you know, not, doesn't tell us in the Bible, so certainly don't go to the bank on that one. But the point is, he looks up. Well, here's what I do know for sure. There were a lot of other people around. Whether they were in the tree or not is irrelevant. There were a lot of other people around there. It says, you know, there was a crowd of people. And out of that whole crowd of people that were there, all of those people that were crowding in to see him and to get close to him, and some probably what we would say, oh, they're very worthy, you know, because our system's a little skewed. But, you know, we would say, oh, they, and out of all of those people, he picks Zacchaeus. The one probably that the rest of them would see as the least likely to be chosen. The least likely for him to say something to. And he responds to him in a personal way, Zacchaeus, today. I'm going to be at your house today. You know, today. The only one mentioned that Jesus reached out to and engaged personally here. Jesus responded to his effort. God does not ignore us, and God does not ignore our efforts. You know, sometimes we think, well, you know, I tried this and I... He doesn't ignore our efforts. He's very clear about that. Deuteronomy chapter 4, he says, but from there you will search for the Lord your God, and what? You will find him. You will find him when you seek him with all your heart, with all your soul. You will find him when you don't simply do a casual pursuit. This is more than a casual pursuit. This is intentionally making time to see him, making time to get to know him, making time to get into his word. Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 13. You will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. With all your heart. Not a casual pursuit, but an effort, a serious effort. God is not hiding from us. You know, he's not hiding from us. He's not avoiding us. He wants us to know him. He wants to spend time with us. He is not, you know, he is not saying, well, I'll just sit here and wait and see if they come by. He wants us to spend time with him. He wants us to get to know him. Put in the effort you need to do to see Jesus. Pick up with me, verse 6. So he, that's Zacchaeus, quickly came down and welcomed Jesus joyfully. All who saw it began to complain. He's calling to lodge with a sinful man. Those two verses to me, when I was reading those, it's just like, we understand, but when you look at the verses, it's really odd. Zacchaeus comes down, you know, quickly and joyfully, and everyone who saw it is complaining because Jesus gave him the attention that they wanted. Because Jesus is, you know, is going to someone who they think isn't worthy. Jesus, when Jesus talks and says something to Zacchaeus, it seems here Zacchaeus responded immediately. He responded immediately when Jesus addressed him. He didn't put it off. He didn't say, you know, I just wanted a glimpse. I'm good now, you know. I'm good. You don't need to come into my house. You know, he didn't come up with other things to do first. Now we've seen the scripture in other places, you know, where that happens. Zacchaeus does, you know, he doesn't waste any time. He doesn't give in to distractions. There's my problem. He doesn't give in to distractions. I'm my own biggest distraction. And I really am. And you know, but it doesn't take much to distract me sometimes. You know, and ask my wife, ask my kids. Ask yourself, you've seen it. You know, it doesn't take much to distract me sometimes. But we give in, you know, you don't give in to these things. And Zacchaeus didn't do that. Quite the opposite of some who encountered Jesus. Luke chapter 9, it says, as they were traveling on a road, someone said to him, speaking to Jesus now, he says, I'll follow you wherever you go. Jesus told him, foxes have dens and birds of the sky have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. Then he said to another, follow me. Lord, he said, first let me go bury my father. But he told him, let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and spread the news of the kingdom of God. Another also said, I will follow you. I will follow you, Lord, but first let me go and say goodbye to those at my house. But Jesus said to him, no one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God. You know, all of these making excuses, all of these other things I need to do, and we come up with all of these other things. I was reading this morning about the fellow we refer to as a rich young ruler. Excuse me, and he comes up to Jesus and, Lord, what must I do to be saved? You know, I've been a good guy. Jesus said, well, you know the commandments. I kept them all. I got them all. That's me. I'm good. You know, what must I do, though, to inherit eternal life? And Jesus tells him, you know, there's just this one thing here that's getting in your way. You know, to get get this out of your way, you know, give away everything you have, you know, sell it and give the money to the poor. And it says he went away sad because he felt it cost him too much. We put a value, you know, on these things, and, you know, whether it's time or whatever, you know, whatever it is. When God tells you to do something, do it. And do it right away, rather than putting it off, rather than waiting till later. When God tells you to do something, do it. You know, follow him, listen to him, do what he says. He is for you, he is not against you. He wants you to grow. He wants to know you. He wants you to be less burdened, not more burdened. He doesn't tell you these things to make things more difficult for you, but to open things up for you in a much fuller, better way. Now, God gives us very clear direction. See, we get all hung up with this, you know, well, God told me to do this or that. I would ask you, is it in line with his word? If it's not in line with his word, then God didn't tell you that, because God's not going to contradict himself. God's not going to tell you to do something other than what's in his word, other than what is in line with his word. Psalm 19 says, the instructions of the Lord is perfect, renewing one's life. The testimony of the Lord is trustworthy, making the inexperienced wise. The precepts of the Lord are right, making the heart glad. The command of the Lord is radiant, making the eyes light up. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The ordinances of the Lord are reliable and altogether righteous. They are more desirable than gold, than an abundance of pure gold, and sweeter than honey which comes from the honeycomb. In addition, your servant is warned by them, and there is great reward in keeping them. He, you know, when we think about, you know, what God has told us to do, we all already know more than we're obeying. You know, we can start obeying his word and to do it right away. Psalm 119 says, how can a young man keep his way pure? By keeping your word. Why? Because his word is true. His word is trustworthy. His word is going to help us be pure. Psalm 119 again, verse 11 says, I have treasured your word in my heart so that I might not sin against you. See, I know your word, I'm familiar with your word, why? So that I won't sin against you, so that I can follow his guidance and his direction and not fall into sin. Verse 105, same psalm. Your word is a lamp for my feet, a light for my path, helping us to see, making it clearer, making things before us, you know, those things that we think sometimes are. I've told you before, and you really need to grasp a hold of this. There is no such thing as a gray area. We talk about gray areas. I am fully convinced there is no such thing as a gray area. God is not the least bit confused about what he wants for you. He is not the least bit wondering about what's right in your life or which way you should go even. He is not the least bit confused. If it's a gray area, is simply something that needs more light. Your word is a lamp for my feet and a light for my path. If Ginny and I don't agree on something, one of us or both of us is wrong. And when we don't agree on something, well, you're the man, you're the head of the... No, what a foolish man will just go ahead and plow ahead with his own thing without consulting his wife and without consulting the Lord. Because if my wife and I can't agree on something, one of us, or possibly both of us, are wrong. And so that is the time that we then need to seek God together for clarity. Why? Because your word is a lamp for my feet and a light to my path, and God is not the least bit confused about what he wants for us. You know, we always wait for this big magical thing and ignore his, you know, and ignore his word. We need to realize the power and the direction of his word. Hebrews chapter 4 says, for the word of God is living and effective and sharper than any double-edged sword, penetrating as far as the separation of the soul and the spirit, joints and marrow. I like that picture. To me, Let me give you Pat's paraphrase. You know, the word of the Lord is living and effective, sharper than any double-edged sword, penetrating as far as cutting away the fat. Of helping us to make sense of life. It is able to judge the ideas and thoughts of the heart. Sometimes we avoid it because we know that the thoughts and the ideas we have are not in line with God. And so we avoid it. 1 Peter chapter 1. By obedience to the truth, having purified yourselves for sincere love of the brothers, love one another earnestly from a pure heart. Since you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, through the living and enduring word of God. It brings life. 1 John chapter 2. I have written to you, children, because you have come to know the Father. I have written to you, fathers, because you have come to know the one who was from the beginning. I have written to you, young men, because you are strong. God's word remains in you. And you have had victory over the evil one. How? Why? Because God's word remains in you. His word is very clear. ...99% of God's will is revealed for you in His word. Know it, learn it, live it. Those who are watching Jesus and Zacchaeus here, they complained about Jesus having anything to do with this chief tax collector. You see, they couldn't get over what Zacchaeus had done. They couldn't get over the person they thought Zacchaeus was. Of all the people here, Jesus, that you decided you were going to have a talk with, that you were going to spend some time with, it was Zacchaeus. You picked Zacchaeus? How in the world could he pick that guy? See, if you focus on other people's sin, you may miss seeing Jesus. They were right there. They were right there seeing all of this. And what did they focus on? He's talking to this sinner. Zacchaeus wanted to learn who Jesus was. They were there, I'm assuming some of them at least were there because they wanted to know who Jesus was. He talks to Zacchaeus and they can't get beyond that. They can't get over that. So they didn't learn anything about Jesus. They didn't learn anything from Jesus because they were so focused on this sinner who was there. Zacchaeus, stop looking at others and start looking at Jesus. And as you see him better, you'll be able to see better to help others see him as well. Those watching, you know, they didn't see Zacchaeus as worthy of attention from God. Do you ever feel that way? You ever feel that way that, you know, a particular person doesn't deserve any attention from God? I was reading a brief article this morning about what some of the Christians in Afghanistan are going through now. You know, in the article was talking about the leader of whatever those folks over there are now. And they said, we have the right to run our country the way we see fit. And I thought to myself, how can anyone be so vile? How could anyone be so foul to do this to another human being? Do you ever feel a particular person doesn't deserve any attention from God? You know, that maybe they're too bad for you to bother with, too bad for you to talk with. Don't buy that lie about others. And let me also tell you, don't buy that lie about yourself. Thinking that you're too bad and that God shouldn't give you his attention because of the person you are. He gives us his attention because of the God he is. It is because of him. You know, it is because of him. It's the reality of who he is. It's the reality of who he is, you know, that helps us know the love and grace of God. After Jesus calls the tax collector Levi, Matthew, not here with Zacchaeus, when he's calling his disciples and he calls Levi, he names him Matthew, to be one of his disciples, Matthew throws a banquet and invites other tax collectors. And it says, when the scribes of and the Pharisees saw that he was eating with sinners and tax collectors, they asked his disciples, why does he eat with tax collectors and sinners? When Jesus heard this, he told them, those who are well don't need a doctor, but the sick do. I didn't come to call the righteous, but sinners. God reaches out to us and to sinners because he is God. Because he is God, not because of the worthiness. He reaches out to the unworthy. Why? Because he is God. And because of his love. We need to move along. If you focus on what other people say, you may miss seeing Jesus. If you focus on what other people say. So, this works from both ends here. The Pharisees had a high position, and the Pharisees loved, you know, they loved that position, and they loved the praise of people, it says. So they didn't see Jesus. Because, you see, they were, this works from both ways, you know, on not focusing on what other people say. If you're focusing on, you know, on the praise from other people, you're going to miss Jesus. You know, you're going to miss what he says. You know, the Pharisees saw somebody gaining the popularity that they wanted to have. If we get focused on the other person who's doing, you know, who's doing better than we are, who's doing more than we are, who seems to be growing more than we are, who seems to be having more than we are, we're going to be focused on that. We're going to miss Jesus. Matthew, on the other hand, had a low position. He was a tax collector. Now, he could have focused on what the Pharisees said about him and walked away from Jesus. Well, they're right, you know. It's tax collectors and sinners. But he didn't. He didn't walk away from Jesus. Even though other people saw him as unworthy, he didn't walk away from Jesus, and he saw Jesus do great things those next 3.5 years as he walked together with him as his disciple. He saw him do great things. Zacchaeus knew what others thought about him. It was no secret. It was no secret what people thought about tax collectors. You know, and he knew that. But he responded to Jesus, and he responded quickly, and he was able to make a real connection with Jesus. Follow along. Verse 8. It says, but Zacchaeus stood there and said to the Lord, look, I'll give half of my possessions to the poor, Lord. And if I have extorted anything from anyone, I'll pay back four times as much. You see, Zacchaeus here, he's so impacted by the fact that Jesus took note of him. He is so impacted by the fact that he wanted to have a relationship with Jesus that he responded, and he responded generously. Now, the law says that a thief had to repay four times that, you know, the amount that was stolen. Notice this. First, Zacchaeus gives away half of all he had to the poor. He gives away half of all he had to the poor, and people say, well, you know, that's probably enough. No, then he goes on and he says, you know, then out of what's left, I'm going to repay fourfold as the Lord requires. He went above and beyond what was required. He was willingly generous. Respond to the Lord with joyful generosity. Respond to the Lord with joyful generosity. Now, here's the what I'm talking about with this. Don't look to simply get by. Don't look for the least that you can do to respond to God. Respond generously. Respond to him generously. Yes, with your finances, but also with your time. You want to see Jesus? You want to see him? Then you need to respond with your time. What you value is reflected in, you know, where you spend your time and where you spend your money. Matthew 6, don't collect for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal. But collect for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust destroys and where neither thieves and where thieves don't break in and steal. And the verse we started with this morning, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. What you value is what you're responding to. What you value is what you are living out. You want to see Jesus? How do you value him? You know, sometimes we think that we can give money and that makes up for the time we don't want to give. No, we should give both to God, and we should give generously. Verse 9. Today salvation has come to this house, Jesus told him, because he too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save the lost. You see, Zacchaeus' actions show that he had a change of heart. It showed that he had a real relationship with Christ because he began to change. He began to live that out. That's what repentance is, that change of living, that change not just in our attitude, but the change in living. The change that comes out is that change of heart, you know, that where the treasure is, there your heart will be also, that we begin to treasure God more than any of these other things. Zacchaeus, notice, and it says as well, all who saw, verse 7 talks about all who saw. They all saw the same interaction. They all saw the same incident with Jesus. They were all viewing the same thing there. The difference, you know, was in all those who saw the incident. You know, they saw, you know, Jesus as an interesting person. They had heard about him. Maybe they saw him do some miracles. They came out to see him, maybe to see him do some miracles again. They felt they knew who he was, you know, and that was all they needed to know about him. Zacchaeus, on the other hand, came because he wanted to know who Jesus was. And when he saw more, he learned more. And what he learned was that Jesus was somebody worth living for. He changed his life. Zacchaeus changed his living to be in line with Jesus. He chose to live following Jesus. Let me ask you again, how do you see Jesus? How do you see Jesus? And what are you doing about it? You know, when you truly see Jesus, it will change your living. Put in the effort that you need in order to see Jesus. Quit making excuses. Put in that effort. Do what God tells you to do. His word is there to guide us. Don't put it off. Do it. And don't be so focused on how bad other people are that you miss seeing Jesus yourself. You know, and don't let other people's opinion of you keep you from seeing Jesus. Listen to him more than you listen to others. And he said, "You are worthy of my son's life on the cross. I love you that much." Listen to what he says. Respond to him with joyful generosity. Your actions are following your heart. Do you want to see Jesus? Do what you need to do to see him. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for opening my heart and my life to you. Thank you for teaching me and giving me people who help me to see you and understand you. Thank you for opening your word. And it's not because I'm a pastor, Lord, it's because you are God. Now, Father, toward that, we want to open our lives and give our lives to you in an unhindered way. Guide us to open our lives to you, to put in the work, the effort, the time, to make you a priority in our living. in our life, we pray. In Christ's name, amen. We're going to sing a closing song. Open our eyes, Lord, we want to see Jesus. Would you stand together as we sing? Majesty, power, dominion, both now and forevermore. And all of God's people said.